So I'm going to be talking about what research says about preventing communication backfires. First, though, don't think of an elephant. So you might be trying really hard, but probably a white elephant or a pink elephant or an elephant you saw at the zoo has popped into your mind. This is actually the title of a book by George Lakoff, and I start my talk with this example for two reasons. The first is that a common way of debunking myths is to repeat the myth and then negate it and go on with the factual information. The problem with this, as you can see from this example, is that simply negating a myth or negating information still emphasizes that information in your mind. It still emphasizes those connections. And so in the process of negating the myth, you're actually giving it credence. The second reason I begin my talk with this is, well, we're very close to a presidential election, and so there's an elephant in the room. Specifically, when we're talking about trust in science and trust in scientists and talking about different scientific issues, to what extent does group affiliation, like political party, influence how people think about different issues? So I have here three different issues: human influence on climate, safety of genetically modified food, and childhood vaccine safety. And I'm just asking the question, does political party influence how people reason about these issues? And you probably have some predictions, so I'm going to do the big reveal now. So political party does influence how people make sense of human influence on climate, but it does not influence how people think about the safety of genetically modified foods or childhood vaccine safety. This is from research by the Pew Research Center, and they found that in general, the public's political views don't influence how they think about science, scientific issues, with the exception of climate and energy. Lately, we've seen some politicization over issues related to the pandemic. So I am going to tell you, and the next slide is going to apply to not just human influence on climate and energy issues, but also to these issues surrounding protecting ourselves from the pandemic and how people are thinking about those. So we want to mitigate cultural clashes. How do we do that? So to the extent that an issue becomes politically polarized, it can create a vicious cycle in that each polarizing cue reminds people that they're a member of a particular political party who's supposed to think about something in a particular way, and that increases the polarization. So to break that cycle, the best thing you can do is try to remove some of those polarizing cues, and that could be imagery or language, for example. This is from Republican strategist Frank Luntz, who changed the way Republicans talked about a number of different issues. An example is drilling for oil became exploring for energy. I'm not suggesting to use these particular words, but this just serves as a reminder that certain words become associated with certain political parties and therefore can be polarizing in that way. Another thing that you can do to mitigate cultural clashes is to work with an ally in the group, or to connect via shared identity. So we're not just one identity. We aren't just members of a political party or members of a religious organization. We're parents, we're pet owners, we're people who have certain hobbies, who do certain things and are parts of groups in our community. Any of those can be a way of connecting to another person, a way of looking at their shared identity and relating to that person through that shared identity. Thirdly, a lot of times we get so caught up on the problem, but we really can focus on sometimes the solution. A lot of times we can agree on the solution, even if we don't agree on every single aspect of the problem. Kimberly Prather just talked about the idea of the fix factor versus the fear factor, knowing that there's aerosols and that's part of how COVID is being transmitted doesn't necessarily have to be so scary if we focus on the solution and that there are really practical solutions to decrease transmission. In addition to that, if you think about the idea of having more ventilation in buildings, opening windows, filtration systems, I think we probably could have agreed that those were good ideas before COVID even came along. So sometimes the solution is actually quite palatable and we don't need to get so caught up in the problem. So these are three strategies for mitigating cultural clashes. But I don't want to give you the impression that the only reason for trust or difficulty you know, believing science is only related to political affiliation. Some of it has to do with how we communicate about these different issues. As scientists and as communicators, we also have a job to do in making sure that the information we're giving is comprehensible and that audiences can use it to make decisions. An example of that was this incredible certitude around the US Surgeon General's statement on masks. The initial statement was very definitive and it had to be retracted less than a month later. And this has gotten a lot of coverage in the media. So, you know, science certainly changes and that's acceptable. But when we think that there might be uncertainty ahead, which is often, we should be really honest and transparent about that. And that doesn't just mean throwing up our, you know, hands in the air and saying, oh, well, we're not certain about this, because that's very frustrating. But instead, clarifying the uncertainty and really trying to give people the information they need to make decisions. And that includes thinking about saying, what is the source of the uncertainty? How big is the uncertainty? And is it resolvable? Sometimes we're in the midst of a study that's going to come out in a couple of months, and we can say that it might be resolvable shortly. And sometimes we can't actually do the experiment that would make it resolvable. And so that's useful information too, both for individuals trying to make a decision and also for policymakers trying to make decisions and trying to talk to their constituencies. This is just a reminder that trust is built gradually over time, sort of brick by brick, but that trust is destroyed often very dramatically, and not just in a building failure or a dam failure or something like that, but in those moments, like that example I gave of the Surgeon General's initial statement on masks, that actually broke down trust a lot. So in being communicators, the asymmetry principle of trust becomes really important, that it's really hard and takes time to build that trust, but it can be destroyed really easily. So part of thinking about this is also looking at how we're going to tackle wicked problems. And so wicked problems is this name that's been used to talk about these big societal problems like climate change, like even thinking about what to do with about the pandemic, because there's so many different facets of that, not just a couple of facets. And of course, scientific findings need to be brought to bear on the wicked problems, but it's so much more than that, right? Because there's all these different aspects and affects our lives in so many different ways. And so part of that is thinking about what different values are brought to bear and thinking about these problems. And it's not just values in the sense of moral or religious values, but rather all the things that we value as humans and how we think about them. And then trading off as we're, you know, trying to work toward a solution, having discussions, these crucial conversations about those trade-offs. Now you might think, well, you know, you could get involved in these philosophical discussions that could go on for a really long time if you're going to do this and have these conversations. But we have to remember that we're trying to work toward a solution. It's a design problem. And when you think about it as a problem of design, it's no longer just a philosophical discussion, right? It's very goal-oriented toward finding a solution. My colleague Kim Rubenstein is going to talk next about having these conversations and active listening. But before that, I just want to sum up and say what I said. I started with this myth about debunking myths. I gave three strategies for negotiating group affiliations, helping to reduce by removing those polarizing cues, working through a shared identity or working with an ally, focusing on the solution, not the problem. I also gave some do's and don'ts of handling uncertainty, highlighted the implications of the asymmetry principle, and left you with this thought of working together on this collaborative design problem, because solutions really are this matter of collaborative design. Thank you.